This is an ABC color presentation. So far, we have seen at the dedication of a new bridge, murder, and spotted in the crowd, that sinister crook, the Bookworm. Great Scott! A Bookworm ploy, a ruse to divert the dynamic duo. While a bomb was placed in the Batmobile. Bomb detected. Ejected. A clue. He was going to blow up the bridge. He did. He blew it up into a giant photograph. Like moths, our heroes followed the light into a bat trap. Was this girl really a prisoner? Was it a trick? One way to find out, put her gently to sleep. Spirit her to the Batcave. Test her. Counter plot. Pretend we fall for her game. The tricky girl turned the tables. And the Bookworm knew just what to do with him. Bind him to the clapper of a giant bell. Do not ask for whom this bell tolls. It tolls for Robin. In just 1 minute, the stroke of midnight doom.
Your old bat chum, John S. Drew here, and we are back with a new villain in the Batman pantheos here. We're going to be dealing with the Bookworm, but I do have a returning guest chum here to help me along in discussing this episode. Back with me once again from the DragonCon American Sci-Fi Classics track and from the RevCast is Mr. Gary Mitchel. Hey, Gary.
Hey, greetings, citizens.
So why Bookworm when I was, like, getting around to the next list of villains?
Roddy McDowell.
Yeah.
That's the main thing. I have been a fan of Roddy McDowell as long as I can remember. I remember being 6 years old and watching the Planet of the Apes movies, other movies, and this episode of Batman made me a lifelong Roddy McDowell fan. And this is one of the episodes when I literally can remember watching this at like 6-7 years old and just like, wow, this guy's cool. He's a great villain.
He was, you know, the episodes we're talking about are the two-parter, The Bookworm Turns While Gotham Burns. They aired on April 20th and 21st of 1966. And sadly, you know, this is the only appearance for Roddy McDowell as the Bookworm, and yet many fans, when they talk about the series, remember his turn as the character.
Well, he's an original villain to the series. He wasn't in the comics.
Right.
And he's got a great hook.
He does.
In that he's got this great, you know, this eidetic memory and speed reading and has all this knowledge in his head and has this really interesting plan. I think that's one of the things. And he's got cool gadgets. I mean, cool gadgets. I mean, it's like, that's always a plus.
And I think he's got the reading light long before the reading light became fashionable on his head.
Mm-hmm.
but it's a shame because, you know, the whole plot around this, and I've only discovered this recently because it's not listed in other sources that I have, is that apparently this episode was actually the first tie-in episode, so to speak. It was a National Readers Week that they were doing mm-hmm. at the time, and they thought, let's do a book-themed episode of Batman to center around it.
That's correct. And so it's one of the key facets of the episodes are the fact that, you know, Bookworm does all this reading, so he has all this knowledge, but Batman reads too, and it's his and Robin's being well-read as well that helps them to figure out what's going on and trump the guy.
And for once, it's not someone who is, I mean, you could certainly say to a certain extent he might be a little maniacal, a little crazed, what have you, but it's not a warped mind. It's a mind that actually thinks logically, and like you say, through books and literature. And he's playing on Batman and Robin's playing field. Batman and Robin always have to sort of, in a way, bring themselves to the playing field of the other villains. This is someone who's more on par with them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and he's definitely the strategic planner guy. I mean, every time they get the fights are about to start, he's like, you know, huddles up with the guys, says, "Okay, go do this, and then I'm going to go over here."
Yes.
I'll be hiding in this box. Go punch Batman.
I do like that. I do like the fact that he just sort of, you know, tucks himself away and such. He collects the glasses and such during the fights before they go off fighting.
Yeah, that's one of my favorite moments with Batman. Wait, your glasses! Remember, Robin, never hit a man with glasses.
There's just a lot of great moments. I mean, I'm coming to this, and I'm trying to, like, not watch the episodes again or go ahead or anything. I want to watch them fresh for the review. And sometimes I've been disappointed with episodes that, as a child, I remembered fondly, and they don't hold up as an adult. This one holds up.
Yes. Well, like I said, he's got a really good plan. It's convoluted, but what do you expect from a guy who, like Batman calls him on it? It's like any, you know, struggling amateur writer, overcomplicates the plot.
Yes. You know, and we get right from the start, we get it's a unique opening for the show because Dick and Bruce are watching in the music room. Oh, no, wait a minute. No, that was in... They're watching in the main room. Aunt Harriet was watching in the music room, which makes me wonder, what is a television doing in the music room? I know they're rich, but I would think the music room would be the music room. But they're watching the dedication of the bridge.
And in Wayne Manor, stately home of millionaire Bruce Wayne and his youthful ward, Dick Grayson.
Bruce, quick! Come here, look!
What is it, Dick?
The crowd there. I just saw the bookworm.
Are you sure?
How could I mistake him? Those crazy clothes that look like rare old book bindings. I'm pretty sure he had on his trick eyeglasses, too. The ones with the secret radio stuff built in.
Strange. What would a crook like the bookworm be doing at the dedication of a bridge?
Let's watch. Maybe he'll show his nasty nose again.
Bookworm to printer's devil.
Bookworm to printer's devil.
Start chapter one.
Devil to bookworm. Gotcha, boss.
Oh. Holy homicide. Tell me I'm having a nightmare.
Steady, Dick. It happened all right.
Commissioner Gordon killed.
This is one time we don't wait for the bat phone.
And it's kind of graphic for 1960s television as he goes falling over into the river.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I have to say, I really appreciate going back and watching these. You know, everybody likes to rib Adam West, but his acting in that scene.
I solemnly swear by my oath as a crime fighter that this outrage will not go unavenged. To the bat poles.
And the follow-up, when they go running off into the library, he really, you can tell, is hit by this. And he's like, you know, I swear on my oath as a crime fighter. It's like, wow, Adam's breaking out the, you know, he's breaking out the serious chops in this scene. That because I think we've seen some deaths on the show before, but this is, you know, somebody he knows and respects.
Right.
And to watch them get, you know, assassinated like that.
And it's early enough in the show that if you're not, like, if you're someone who doesn't know the Batman mythos and such, you might honestly think that maybe they were offing Gordon.
Yeah.
You know, it's a surprise. But the one thing I do have a problem with, though, is where was Alfred during all this? Because they go, all right, Aunt Harriet, we're going to go and pay our respects in the city. I mean, they've got their excuse, but they leave the woman alone.
Mm-hmm.
I felt bad.
Well, maybe it was just time to be dusting the atomic pile.
Oh, man. But, you know, they quickly make their way to, you know, Gotham City and Police Commissioner Head's, you know, Gordon's headquarters there. And they find, you know, not nothing happened. I mean, it didn't happen. In fact, if anything, we get this moment of hilarity, lightness, where Gordon's like, and I got ticketed by a cop.
Yeah. Yeah, up until he shows in, it's very somber, and all the cops, you know, wailing, and Chief O'Hara.
Oh, he's
bad. And I have to say, I love his reaction when the commissioner comes in, and he's like, he starts laughing.
Yeah.
You know, you can see the relief and the, oh, good, you're not dead. And then the commissioner going, you want to go to the sanitation department?
Oh, no, I agree. I absolutely agree. You know, it's funny because it's all part of that whole innocence of the time, though, that you can one moment have something so dramatic, and then the next mm-hmm. moment, you know, the relief of being alive. I mean, yeah, we certainly get it in today's dramas as well, but I think they overplay it way too much sometimes.
Oh, yeah. And I also love how long it takes for Commissioner Gordon to go, wait a minute, Batman, what the hell are you doing?
Yes. Oh, yeah, that's true. That's true. You know, when we're first also introduced to the bookworm and we see his outfit, you know, that's a pretty amazing looking outfit, being the leather clad person he is. I'm surprised he doesn't collapse from the weight of it and the heat that he must be feeling.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, just the way Dick describes it, like, I saw a bookworm in that crazy getup of his. It looks like old book bindings.
Yes.
Yeah, and I love the fact that every time he moves, he squeaks.
Yeah, they don't try and cover it up.
Yeah, and it's actually a really interesting looking outfit. I mean, that brown leather, and even if he wanted to fight, you know, leather's good protection.
Yes.
You know, but it's a fancy hat and the glasses, and I mean, he's like a couch.
Yes. Yes. But, you know, while they're in the office there and they're all relieved that Gordon is alive and all, you know, one of Bookworm's, you know, flunkies is there and he's reporting to Bookworm that the Batmobile is outside and all. And we also get the first look at Bookworm's mole, Lydia. Mm-hmm. And she's just as interesting to look at as the Bookworm, but for other reasons.
Yes. Yes, yes. She's very nice.
Yeah. Yeah.
The Batman series always had some very, very nice-looking malls.
They always had some nice-looking malls, and what I also thought was interesting, considering at the same time Star Trek is running on television mm-hmm. there, Lost in Space is running on television, those two shows tended to push the envelopes a little bit with the women and the way they were dressed, leaving you almost sometimes, especially in Star Trek's case, with nothing to the imagination. Batman never really went that far. They were sexy, they were attractive, they were wow, you know, but they were always covered up well.
Mm-hmm. You covered up well, but they still showed things off nicely. I mean, all you have to do is look at the Catwoman outfit and just like,
Yeah.
There's a reason we all still revere and love Julie Newmar.
Yes.
And Eartha Kitt.
And Eartha Kitt.
Yeah, and I just love that once again the plan is, all right, let's put a bomb in the Batmobile since it doesn't have a roof.
But the Batmobile can detect explosive devices. I love this.
What on earth was the point of that charade?
I don't know. It could have been merely... The bomb detector of the Batmobile. It's flashing red.
Quick, hit the radio control ejector button.
I love this. And it comes back to what I've said before. In the first season, the Batmobile is more like a character itself. It's given, you know, almost a sentience in the sense that it can detect explosive devices. When there's fire, it can put itself out. You know, it mm-hmm. it just doesn't sit there and wait for orders. It does it.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah, just get Batman's talking in the office, all of a sudden, beep, 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 oh, it's a bomb! Quick, hit the eject button! And I love that the fact that the seat doesn't move at all, just whatever's sitting in it. Whee!
But I do also like, after they get the bomb exploded, you know, ejected and such, and they're talking more about the bookworm's schemes, and I think mm-hmm. it's Batman who comments that the schemes are like a frustrated writer who steals from different parts. And like you said, it becomes this, but that's kind of meta in a way, because wasn't that, up until this point, wasn't that what Batman was doing, the TV series, was stealing the plots from the comics?
Oh, very much so. Yeah, and I love the fact that Printer's Devil is just sitting there, like, faking eating a sandwich, like, bomb blew up in front of me. I don't care. I'm just sitting here reading my book. Just no big deal. It's just Gotham.
It's just Gotham, exactly.
The Batman asks you, "Did you see anything?" "Nope. You said they blew up." "Well, you should go away, citizen." "Oh, okay."
Oh.
"Nothing suspicious about me at all. I'm out of here."
Nothing like that. That's right. Oh. And I think this is the first time, we get a couple of firsts in this episode, because I think this is the first time as Batman and Robin have to make an emergency bat turn and we see the parachutes come out and everything. But this time Batman, and I think they must have gotten like somebody commenting on this, because Batman tells Robin, call up the parachute pickup.
Yeah, I love that. I love the fact that there's got to be some guy. What do you do all day? My job is to sit in a van and wait for Batman to call me to go pick up his parachute.
But
it's a good gig. I just sit on the side of the road. I've got a book and everything.
Well, you know, when you think about it, because like I remember as a kid, you know, for the longest time, I didn't know that Spider-Man's webs only lasted an hour. And I was like thinking, he's shooting these things all over the city. He's an ecological menace with all these webs. And then I finally read in the comic book about how it dissolves. And I'm like, oh, okay, that's cool. So I was like, so probably somebody's like, yo, and Batman's like shooting around the city and, oh, made a mistake. Let's turn around, leave those parachutes behind. So that's actually a good thing that there's somebody just on call, and it's all on Bruce Wayne's dime, so why not?
Yeah, it's good to be rich. Money is the best superpower. Just ask Bruce Wayne and Tony Stark.
We also get in this our first wall cameo.
I have the curious feeling this is all some kind of literary plot.
Let's outwit him, Batman. Let's refuse to bite.
We must, Robin. It's the only way we can...
Batman! Oh, you must be, because that's Robin. Hi, Robin.
Yes, citizen, but don't be alarmed. We're here on official business.
Holy human flies.
Yes.
Mr.
And
Jerry
what a
Lewis.
Cameo.
Yeah.
I mean, who, let's face it, I mean, 1966, Jerry Lewis, that's a big get.
Jerry Lewis on TV, if it wasn't a variety show, here's Jerry Lewis, who's, you know, box office star and all, and now he's coming out of the wall talking to Batman and Robin.
And it's just like, wow, it's Batman and Robin. Like, yes, citizen, it's okay. Wow. And he throws out it's a Robinism. It's great. And then back in. It's like, and that's what I like about it. It's a very brief cameo. It's not one of the ones where they dragged it out.
Yeah, over time they would really start to abuse it. But this one was cute and just, you know, and it also made sense. Because there's future ones where you're wondering, like there's one where they're climbing up the wall or down the wall of police commissioner's, you know, Gordon's headquarters there. And Dick Clark appears. I'm like, what is Dick Clark doing in Gotham City's police headquarters?
Throwing a party, apparently. Because I remember it's just like, you hear music.
Yes, there's music playing, too. But then again, that was also the episode, I think, where the Archer and his men were hiding out anyway in the basement. So God only knows what's going on in Gordon's headquarters there all the time. You know, what's Bonnie up to?
<He's> right.
Secretary. Well, they, you know, they follow the clues. Like we said, there's these weird twisted clues and such, and they follow it to, if I remember correctly, you know, it's the bookmobile. Wasn't that it there?
Well, they figure out, because the cover of the book that blew up was For Whom the Bell Tolls,
right.
Which the plot of the book is to blow up a bridge. And they're like, oh, well, that explains the bridge. And then they hear there's a picture being of the bridge being projected on the, I forget what that building it was.
Right.
And so they climb the building and they see the projector, and he's like, ah, that's it. They blew up, photography speak, blew up the bridge, and they're projecting it, which is, again, convoluted plot. You know, it's like, oh, well, there's a projector, so let's go. And it's off the top of a stolen bookmobile.
And then they use, like, you know, sonics to drive them all out, and they use 12,000 decibels. And I'm like thinking, isn't that going to shatter their eardrums?
That's one of the things I wanted to look up after I watched that, because I'm like, this is sci-fi writers not having a sense of scale again, isn't it? Because 12,000 decibels, I actually had to look this up. A jet engine is 140 decibels.
Wow.
The loudest sound possible is 194 decibels. And at 140 decibels, as it quote says here, according to Galen Carroll Audio, even short-term exposure can cause permanent damage. Louded recommended exposure with hearing protection, 140. So it's like Batman just blew out all these people's eardrums.
But he blew out all their eardrums, and yet they managed to come out, and we get a bat fight.
Hero Jeewers, out of the attack. Page 14, chapter 6, paragraph 2. Into action!
That's a pretty cool little fight, and I love how it ends with them throwing each guy into the boxes, and then... Wait a minute, where'd they all go?
Your glasses!
Remember, never hit a man with glasses.
And then Batman's great line is, like all worms, they went into the under the ground.
Yeah. I mean, they play up everything about, you know, a bookworm, and they take some of the best plots that, you know, I don't know about kids today, but kids at the time would recognize. Oh, kids today and what they read. Never mind. And you know, but Lydia doesn't get away. Lydia's there, you know, she's tied up.
Machiavellis! 8, 3, 9, 6, retreat! The cowardly worms, where are they going?
Where worms always go. Down into the earth. They've wiggled through that secret trap door. Doubtless they had it all prepared.
But why, Batman? Why lure us here and then run?
Good question, Robin. And one which has baffled us from the very beginning of this case. Why?
Because the bookmobile, you know, is there. So, you know, I don't know if that's from the Gotham City Library or what, but it's a bookmobile with books in it and such.
Right.
And Batman decides to take her to the Batcave in order to get the information. And again, this is the first time anyone's been taken to the Batcave, like, by Batman willingly. Or, well, I guess you could say in the first episode he figured out pretty quickly that Jill St. John wasn't really Robin, but so there's a lot of firsts.
Yeah, but he sprays her with the anesthesia stuff, going, "I'm very sorry, but I have to be sure." Yeah, and the bat truth detector.
Yes. Yes, the bat truth. That's also pretty. I always liked it when anybody from the outside went into the Batcave, whether it was unintentionally or intentionally. You know, in the Batman movie, Penguin's got his dehydrated thugs.
Yes.
Or King Tut manages to stumble upon it with his men, and there's a big fight in the Batcave. You know, things like that. Even if it wasn't the best episode, you still got a thrill out of seeing that.
Yeah, because it's something new in the Batcave.
Mm-hmm. They don't.
But they interrogate the girl, and right. She's kind of under some sort of hypnosis or something.
Right.
What is your name?
Lydia Limpet.
Do you know where you are?
Of course. I'm in back of Bookworm's bookmobile.
It rings true, Batman. She doesn't even realize she's in the Batcave.
Get set for the big one. What is Bookworm's plot?
I don't know. He hasn't confided it to us.
Darn it all! Another true answer.
I only know he can't pull it off till Batman and Robin have perished.
Turn that machine off.
What are we gonna do, Batman?
Only one thing we can do. And quickly, before that bat gas wears off.
And that's what leads to Robin tripping up, which I like.
What did you like about that, though?
Well, I like the fact that it's an honest mistake. It's not that, you know, somebody, you know, did something stupid. You know, it's like they question her, they get her name, they find out, yes, she is actually working for Bookworm. They take her back to the bookmobile and apparently just leave her tied up the whole time.
Yeah, they leave her tied up. They also find out because, like, she doesn't know anything about the whole plan. He won't make his move, though, until the two are out of the way.
Right.
Yeah. So they kind of have to kind of go along with it and see what happens next then, because they have no other choice.
Right. So Batman runs off willingly and knowingly into the trap, but knowing it's a trap, it's going to be okay, as he explains to Robin. Then Robin goes back in to basically babysit the girl until the cops show up, and he says, "Don't worry, Miss Lydia, it's going to be fine." And that's when she's tipped off the, "How did they know my name?"
Mm-hmm. Exactly, yeah. Because she doesn't remember any of her experience in the Batcave.
Right.
Right.
Yeah, and gets Robin to, "Would you read to me?"
Oh, these books put me to sleep.
Yes.
Literally, they do. Once Robin is knocked out, he's tied to the clapper in the Gotham Clock Tower, a timepiece donated by Bruce's father. Mm-hmm. Nice little bit of continuity there.
What time is it?
Oh, 1 minute to midnight, Bookworm.
60 tiny seconds. Oh, farewell, Boy Wonder. Adieu, Robin. Oh, this is the last time that you will meddle in affairs of moment. Oh, I tried to warn you. Do not ask for whom this spell tolls. It tolls for thee. Holy headache!
Holy midnight! The first minute of the new day. The everlasting end for Robin. Stick merciful cotton in your ears. The death knell sounds tomorrow. Same bat time, same bat channel.
Batman realizes this is, you know, all been a trap when he heads back there. And there's Chief O'Hara. And,
yes.
I mean, I love, because again, I don't know, you might look at it as overdoing it, or you might look at it as just someone who's genuinely concerned about Robin and has to, you know, as he says,
"The tricky devils. They've turned the tables and caught Robin. I'll call headquarters. Throw out the dragnet."
"No, wait a minute, Chief O'Hara.
Let me turn my memory back. He strikes at midnight, she said."
"But we know the Bookworm's changed his plan."
"Don't interrupt. I'm trying to fathom the subconscious of a deadly criminal.
He strikes at midnight. The metaphor suggests
a clock."
"A clock called he?"
"Of course. And there's only one clock in Gotham City that is called he.
Saints alive. Big Benjamin in the Wayne Memorial Clock Tower.
And it fits in with the plan. Do not ask for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee."
Yeah, I love the way he does the crossing his hands and with his, you know, with the index middle finger sticking out and doing the little, like, trance thing. Of, It's like, wow, okay.
Yeah. And again, another first. Chief O'Hara gets to ride in the Batmobile.
Mm-hmm. And I love the fact that he's terrified.
Yes.
You know, because, you know, Batman's just all business. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you have the green, the bat rear projection behind him. But O'Hara just keeps throwing his hands over his face going, "Oh, my God, we're going too fast."
But see, that's good because, you know, I mean, as pretty much everybody knows, the Batmobile really wasn't going that fast. It's just sped up film. So it was good that he, you know, maintains the illusion that this is a fast car and it's a little terrifying to ride in it.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's Batman's a maniac. He's a menace to public safety.
Oh, man. And,
But I do love the way how intense Adam West is in these scenes, because, like, he's really worried about Robin.
Yep. Yeah, he is. Well, I mean, that's the one thing, at least, that's always consistent throughout the series, is that, you know, as much as Robin is his partner, there is that part of him that it will always be, you know, to the point that sometimes, especially in the Catwoman episodes, it will distract him, you know, his concern for Robin. And he'll have his eye off the ball, so to speak, in catching the criminal.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then, of course, we get the cliffhanger of the at midnight, the clapper will strike and end Robin.
Right, right. Now, one thing, though, all right, here's he goes through all this, and yet he takes also the time to give a science lesson, Batman. Time's running out. Why is he bothering with a science lesson and explaining this to, Chief O'Hara?
Yeah, I'll tell you in a minute. Again, that's another one of the things of this episode is like, this goes back to the decibels. He's like, I'm going to attach these electrodes to the clock hands and to the weather vane or whatever it was.
Right.
And pump 12,000 volts of electricity through this thing. I'm like, isn't Robin tied to that bell? Didn't you just electrocute him? Well, the good news is we didn't crush Robin's skull. The bad news is.
Yeah. And what is a brain-drenched mind?
Ah, I'm glad you said that. I love that line. I actually made sure to write it down. It's my brain-drenched mind has done it again. And that's actually a scene which has one of my favorite things about Bookworm, which we didn't mention earlier when we saw his first scene in his hidey hole, which is a library, where the way he'll flip out. Mm-hmm. I mean, he spends so much of the episode as like kind of this repressed intellectual of the whole, quote, chapter, page. But when things don't go his way, he gets scary and flips out.
Yes. And it's not a childish tantrum either.
No. Yeah. It's a scary tantrum.
Like, if that were today and they were playing, he'd probably be pulling out the gun and just shooting people randomly, until he calmed down.
Mm-hmm.
He
almost kills, he picks up that gigantic book.
Yes.
Which turns out the secret of success, self-control, which turned out to be handy. But he was going to bash Miss Piven's brains in with it.
Yes. Yep.
And then I love the way he does the speed reading. And reads the whole book. His mind is so good. He'll read that book in seconds. And I love the fact he's like, big tantrum, and then okay, I'm calm again. I'm under control. he's a fascinating villain because of that.
Yes. And Roddy McDowell just, from that, almost sublime, very gentle, very, thoughtful, and to the maniac. He just switches back and forth so easily.
Mm-hmm. You can see why this guy is a villain. Why he's a cross-stream crook. Because with that kind of temperament, there's no way he's going to be anything else.
Yeah. But now here's another thing I don't get. I mean, maybe this is just Wayne Manor and I'm rich and I can do whatever I want. We've got a TV in the music room. We have a priceless first edition cookbook in the living room that Bookworm manages to steal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love that. And again, it's like, Batman's down in the Batcave and he just strolls up. I love the fact that even though Dick and Bruce recognized him instantly when he was on TV of, hey, that's Bookworm at the bridge, Bookworm just drives up to Manor, and Alfred's like, oh, it's the bookmobile. Why are you dressed like a book?
Yes. Yeah, Alfred just lets him in.
Yeah.
And in Wayne Manor, stately home of millionaire Bruce Wayne and his youthful ward, Dick Grayson, the plot is about to take a strange new twist.
Is it, Alfred?
It's a gentleman from the bookmobile service, madam.
Oh, how nice. Bring him in.
This way, sir.
How do you do? What do you recommend this week? Something for reading before going to sleep?
Ah, well, I believe that you will find this volume extremely effective, Mrs. Cooper.
Oh, Congressional Record, March 1919.
Oh, it's the illustrations, Mrs. Cooper. They are so piquant.
Oh, you don't say. Look, Alfred.
And I love just the fact that, when he goes to steal the book, he like checks the lock. He's like, oh, it's locked. Well, just smash.
Nothing, no finesse now, just that's it. I want it, let's go.
Mm-hmm.
Which shows that duality again, though. That whole, he could have been like, he could have had a book on picking locks. He could have, sped Reddit and done that or something like that. No, not right now. Smash, let's go.
Yeah, I mean, he could have had a gadget or something. That's the other thing. I love his gadgets. The headlamp. I love the radio in his glasses.
Yes. Yeah.
That's a cute trick.
Well, the radio in his glasses, that's going to be something that they'll pick up on in the Green Hornet in the second season of Batman. You know, the Green Hornet runs at the same time on ABC. And District Attorney Scanlon, every time he, you know, is contacted by the Hornet, that the Hornet needs to talk to him, they don't actually have the radio itself. It's not like he talks to it, but he gets a buzzing in his glasses, and he's like, I have to go now.
Yes.
Yeah.
I love the Green Hornet.
I know. Yeah, don't even get me into that, though, about how...
Yeah.
To me, that was the low point, though, for Batman. As much as it was cool to see Batman and the Green Hornet together, it just wasn't a story worthy of either of them.
No.
Yeah.
But getting back on point, I mean, he steals the book and at the same time puts the giant cookbook in the middle. You know, I love the fact that, you know, this is Gotham City. Oh, giant book. Where'd this come from? I don't know. Didn't you notice anybody dropping it off? No, just suddenly it was there.
In the middle of the day, even.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I you're right. I love the set. I love the fact that, you know, this is first season, and they went all out, whether it was the giant umbrella in the Penguin episode, the big Sphinx in the King Tut episode, or now this book, you know, that just appears out of nowhere. Okay, but still, you know, there's just a certain, almost a cinematic quality to it, because you just don't expect to see anything that gigantic on a live, like, outdoor set. You know, you might see it, you know, in a studio set, but this is outdoors, and it's like, that is so cool. You know, and then, of course, Batman, the recipes in this book could be explosive.
Yes, everybody golfed. Go hide to the side streets. And I love they use the magnet gun.
Yes.
Magnet rifle to try to open the door open the book.
Exactly. And the way they just approach the book so carefully as they're using the magnet gun. You know. But of course it's a trap. You know,
yes.
The whole thing. Once they get inside the book, which is hollowed out, and it's a kitchen. Well, it's a cookbook. There should be a kitchen in a cookbook.
Smells like soup.
Darn good soup.
Right you are. Bat soup. And
in you go.
Oh, holy stew pot!
Bookworm to Batman.
He's got this place wired. I bet he's watching and listening, too.
Well, of course I'm listening.
Bookworm, what are you up to?
It's a curious old recipe I discovered in the Alchemist's Cookbook, Vienna, dated 1534.
How to steam a bat.
I think he means it.
Of course I mean it, boy wonder. Watch now, while I turn up my radio-controlled double boiler.
Double for dynamic duo.
Cook well, my bat-eared friends. While you are stewing down, I shall be pulling off the crime of the century with the aid of your Batmobile.
Happy juices.
And I love the fact that the stove is cooking soup and Robin actually checks it and says, it's good soup.
Well, good meal for the condemned.
Yes.
You know? So they're trapped inside. The heat starts to build up, you know. And while they're in there, you know, Bookworm steals the Batmobile.
Mm-hmm. How many times has the Batmobile been stolen by this point?
You know, now, did I remember correctly? Because it's been a little while since I watched. Did they leave the engine running?
Yeah, he says, yeah, we even left the engine on.
Oh, God. I guess they had to fix, because it's been explained the Batmobile has an anti-theft device. Although last week's episode with King Tut didn't seem to stop him. He stole the Batmobile then too.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't realize just how often the Batmobile was stolen.
Yeah, because in the episode that we did with the Penguin, Penguin gets it because, you know, Batman's dead, so of course I'm going to take the Batmobile.
Capital idea. Yeah.
You know, but yeah, it's like, it's just like, this car, he needs to put a roof on this thing. He really does.
I like, though, the fact that they contact Alfred to get help, and Alfred's pretty nimble.
He is. He's very nimble for his age.
Wow. I mean, when he did that little hop over and everything, I was like, wow, that's pretty cool.
Mm-hmm. Way to go, Mr. Napier.
Yes.
But yeah, and I love the fact that he's like, Rob, Alfred's a creature of habit. It's his time to be dusting the atomic pile.
Yes.
It's like, no, it's like, you keep forgetting it. Oh, yeah, there's an atomic reactor under Wayne Manor. Why? Bat reasons.
Yes, yes. And they managed to get the plans for the area, for the yes. You know, the whole, the street there on and such from Alfred. But meanwhile, outside, you know, Gordon is trying to coordinate an effort to open the thing. And, you know, he's like, who's our best safecracker? And again, this is a nice little nod, and it would be true based on everything we've seen so far. They're like, oh, the Riddler, but we'll never get him here in time.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, which is, it's a great scene. And I also, the fact that this is when we finally find out what this whole convoluted plan was.
Right.
And the reason Bookworm needed Batman and Robin dead is he needed the Batmobile, because he needed the bat beam to break into this really well-fortified library.
Yes.
Which had something like, what was it, 12 Gutenberg Bibles and a bunch of first editions of these other rare books.
Mm-hmm. And again, this is a nice touch with the whole first scene. You don't really know what the plot is. I mean, yeah, like you say, it's convoluted. But it's convoluted, but it's fun at the same time. So you're okay with the convolution, because there's a lot of great lines. There's a lot of humor, some good jokes. There's some dramatic moments with Adam West and such, whether it was over the death of Gordon or you know, Robin, you know, trying to rescue him in time and such, that it all pays out. And then you get, finally, at the end, whereas, you know, we get into the second season, we're going to know what their plots are right from the very start. It really then is just chasing them around, you know, until we catch them. And that's where it loses its steam. This holds up this episode for that reason.
Yeah. And speaking of steam, when they find the cops finally get in, they think, oh, no, Batman and Robin have been vaporized.
Yes.
But the steam, because they get in there and they're gone.
Well, that's another staple of the series in a lot of the episodes, is that either, the villains, the city of Gotham, whatever. Everybody thinks Batman and Robin are dead, and so the criminals go ahead with their plan, which gives us the nice big reveal.
Now, for the Batbeam.
Melted. Fantastic.
My fine twisty worms! Follow me!
They'll follow you, Bookworm.
Right back into the woodwork of the prison carpenter shop.
Impossible.
How did they escape?
Thought you had us cooked, huh?
We escaped through the manhole under your stove.
The one you used to introduce your murderous steam pipe.
It's an old mistake, Bookworm. Armoring the walls but leaving the floor unprotected.
How did they discover our objective?
You're talking the Batmobile was picked up by a secret mic.
It was relayed to us via the automatic feedback circuit in our Batcave.
Let's clean house, Batman.
Now, Robin.
Glasses off!
All right, my fine twisty worms.
Attack!
And I love the fact they wait until after the wall has been blown open to come out. It's like, should we keep them from breaking into the building? No, no, no. They haven't committed a crime yet. All right, now.
Now.
I love the way in this fight and in the first fight, the way they would run around in a circle.
Yes.
Around Batman and Robin and then charge.
Now, what do you think the purpose of that was?
Kill time. Either that or try to do some sort of confuser rope-a-dope kind of thing, but that's the only thing I can think of. But this fight, I think that's more ridiculous when the guys grab that log, which is laying in the alley for some reason, and put the one guy in front of it and run like a battering ram. What is your plan here, fellas?
Well, it just sort of goes to show you that, you know, they're not fighters, they're all readers.
You should have learned much sooner, Miss Leavitt. The oldest plot, and still the best. Crime does not pay.
And I love the fact that, you know, we get the cuts of the lady watching the fight with her glasses through the little window, and Roddy McDowell hiding in the trash can. Like, go, my minions, I'll be over here. And then when the fight's over, the way Batman and Robin just run over and do the bada 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 on the trash can. I pull it open, and there he is sitting there with the goofiest look on his face, with his tongue sticking out.
And you know what? I was fine with it. Thank goodness, though, they didn't have Tweety Birds playing.
Yes.
I was fine with it. I was like waiting and saying, oh, no, wait a minute. They're going to do Tweety Birds, aren't they, or something like that. No, they didn't. Thank God.
Second and third season, I bet they would have.
Probably would have. Yeah, I'd agree with that. Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. And they haul him out, and they, of course, the you know, the greatest, oldest, greatest lesson, crime does not pay.
And this is another episode where, you know, and there are not too many of them, the mole has no remorse for what she did. You know, she goes off with Bookworm and the rest of the gang. I mean, you expect Bookworm to have no remorse. You expect him to, you know, I'll get you next time and all that stuff. But usually the mole always starts to weaken it. No, off I go with Bookworm. His fate is my fate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, usually they would try the whole, oh, I was an innocent girl roped into this. Can't you let me go? Nope. I'm a crook.
That's it. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Going over Bookworm again as we start to finish this episode here. Bookworm, mm-hmm. you know, all right, like you said, can speed read. He's got mm-hmm. that leather outfit, which, as I said, must be very uncomfortable, but as a kid, I wanted it.
Oh, yeah.
I know that's going to sound so extremely nerdy, but it's like I already had the glasses, so give me the damn leather outfits.
Yeah. At least let me look cool. Because it looks really cool. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think there's a reason that when they brought the show back as this comic book they've got going now, the first villain is Bookworm.
I don't know, though. I can't seem to find any reason why he was never brought back.
From my understanding, it's they just never came up with another plot with him, and Roddy McDowell was probably expensive.
Well,
he was huge.
He was huge, and he was on the verge of becoming even bigger because Planet of the Apes was you know, coming down the pipe for
yes.
him. So, you know, let's see. I'm looking here at Joel Eisner's official Batman Bat Book. It was mm-hmm. a show. This is Roddy McDowell. It was a show that everyone wanted to do at that period. It was such fun. They were larger-than-life cartoon characters, which are very interesting to play. I love being part of the whole series. The costume, though, was very hot to wear. It was a yep. wonderful part. I think there was talk about doing three episodes, but I don't know what happened because there was only one segment. I don't know whether they changed their minds about the Bookworm or whether I was doing other things. So, you know, it could have been he was just busy.
That's probably the most likely explanation, I think, especially if he's doing the Planet of the Apes movies, which they were churning those out like every 2 years.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. And he would go on, though, to have another part in, you know, televised Batman. He'd play the Mad Hatter in the animated series.
Yes.
Yeah.
And did it beautifully.
Yes. Yes, he did. I also just wanted to briefly talk about Lydia, the mole, because she was played by Francine York. And
yes.
IMDb describes her as tall, statuesque, and well-endowed.
And yes, yes, and yes.
Yes, yes, and yes.
She wears that tight red top. Mm-hmm. And it's like, yes, I can see why you keep her around.
Yes. You know, it's fun because it's obvious from the moment she walked on to the, you know, in the first scene that described her perfectly. And considering fashions of the 60s and the way bras were and such, you might have thought she was a little enhanced, but that was not the case.
Yeah, she's wearing the traditional 60s torpedo bra, as I like to call them.
Right. Yeah.
And she's not a dimwit either. I mean, she's not exactly, you know, she's still a flunky. She's, you know, the part of their role is to go, what's that or what's the plan or whatever. But she's not stupid.
No, she's not stupid at all. Yeah.
You know, she instantly twigs to the fact that something's up, that Robin knows her name.
Mm-hmm. She's also one of these ones that while Bookworm has her there, you know, because very few times you see this also with the mole, only unless they betray, you know, the villain to Batman, mm-hmm. are they in any danger. In this case, it's just, you know, she screwed up. You know, she didn't do it on purpose. It was just, and his, again, we see, like you said, the anger and such.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, she's the one that makes the comment in the first part where, which reveals the whole reason that drives Bookworm to be a crook, the fact that he can't write his own original novel because he has, as he says, he has no originality. All he can do is copy plots.
Mm-hmm.
when she says, gee, with your brain, why don't you write a book? And that's when he first flies off the handle, because that's his button.
Yeah.
You know, that's his big don't touch the don't button. And he's like, ah! And the first time he flips out, and he's going to bash her in the head then with that book.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then I love the film at the beginning of the second episode when the bell is supposed to go off. She's, oh, here's a nightingale. And that's again when he just kind of, I love the way he just kind of looks at her for like 2 seconds and then he flips out and everybody's like, ah, and then he gets himself under control. And I also love his little affectation after that when they're thinking, trying to figure out what to do before the my brain drenched mind quote, where he pulls his glasses off, hands them to her, puts his fingers over his lips for about 2 seconds, and then has her hand him his glasses back, and he goes, okay, new plan.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. You know, he's it's funny because we always talk about Roddy McDowell and you know, the voice and the affectations and the way he, but he's also, you know, in many respects, and he had to be, especially for like when you got to Planet of the Apes, he's a very physical actor.
Yes.
Yeah. You know. Because his face was covered, you know, obviously in the ape mask and such. So he had to, you know, the little, like when he would, you know, and the mouth would move along with it and such, you know, just sort of to add to the, and make the character come alive.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It shows you he wasn't phoning in the performance. Like, yes. Like we're going to see with, you know, I know I keep saying this, but it's, you know, it's going to happen. You know, some of these people are just there. Because they're having some fun, but they're really not getting into it the way McDowell did with this, or Cesar Romero did with the Joker, or even Vincent Price did with Egghead.
Oh, Vincent Price.
Yes. And again, I like the henchmen. We've got, you know, names for them. We've got Pressman. Yes. We've got Printer's Devil. We got Typesetter. You know.
Yes.
Books. I mean, he's the bookworm, and I said again, you know, a lot of these are stories that the kids may recognize. Some of them obviously not, they're for jokes. We had A Study in Scarlet, For Whom the Bell Tolls, Art of the Attack, Complete English History, The Congressional Record of 1919, The Alchemist Cookbook, To a Mouse, and The World's 100 Greatest Crimes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, which we haven't talked about, the little denouement of Bruce Wayne with Commissioner Gordon doing the donation to the prison library system.
Yes.
$5,000, which in 66, that's a lot of cash.
That was a lot of cash. I would buy you a lot of books.
Yes. And of course, you know, we have to get, you know, Batman trumping Bookworm when Bookworm comes in. And, you know, I love the fact that, would you like to see him? Can we show off the criminal to the rich guy? And Bookworm does the quote, and Bruce Wayne corrects him. No, it wasn't the bard who's, you know, the poet, you know, Shakespeare, who said that. It was, and I forget the quote now, but it was like so-and-so in this book, and Bookworm's just like, puh, puh, puh. Yeah. And all the fact that the mole is reading that Book of 100 Crimes, and Commissioner Gordon's like, is there no hope for you?
Yes. Oh, clearly not. I if they had done it again, I would have wanted her back as well, though, if that was going to be. I mean, because, you know, Joker comes back. He's always got a different mole, Penguin, and such. I would have wanted him to have Lydia with him.
Yes.
Yeah.
She was good. She was a good mole. She's a good henchwoman.
Mm-hmm. No, she definitely was. She definitely was. The writer of this episode is Rick Villartz. And, you know, there's not much to really say about him here. I mean, he writes a really good episode. It's the only one I think he does for the series. He wrote for other episodic television of the 60s. He wrote for Star Trek. He did For the World is Hollow and I Can Touch the Sky.
That's a good one.
That's a good one. Especially for a third season, you know, Star Trek episode. That's actually one of the better ones. Absolutely.
Yeah.
He also wrote several episodes for Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea. So we've got two extremes going on there.
Irwin Allen. God love him.
Yes. Yeah. So what's your favorite Bat gadget?
I think it's going to have to be the remote ejector.
Okay.
Just, you know, oh, there's a bomb. Boom.
I'm going to go with the Bat magnet.
Yeah.
You know.
The magnet's cool.
The magnet's cool, and just the way they poised themselves as they're moving towards the book. I mean, just that whole serious, You know, it's, I don't know. Yeah. It you know, you stop and you think, and you're like, you're grown men in tights, and you've got this, you know, prop in your hand, and yet they play it off, you know, with all seriousness. And that's the best part of when you've got something that no matter how outlandish, if the characters stay in character, if the actors stay in character, mm-hmm. you're willing to buy the concept and go along with them.
Yeah. Well, camp only works if you play it to a certain level of seriousness. If you play it knowing it's camp, it just, you're overdoing it and it doesn't work.
All right, trivia question. What was the name of the giant cookbook?
Oh, I don't remember.
It was a take on the joy of cooking.
Oh, it was the delight of cooking,
there
wasn't it?
There you go, that's it.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, that was, and it was an interesting cover on that.
Yes, it was. Yeah.
And I love the fact that when they opened it, the first page of the flyleaf has the ex libris, the bookworm.
Well, you know, we've got to have those little touches. Mm-hmm. All right, so let's wrap this thing up here, and you are Robin.
And who was our director?
Who was our director? Larry Pierce.
Because I think he did a very serviceable job.
He did. No, he absolutely did, but the name doesn't, like, you know, ring any bells with me.
Yeah.
You know, as far as, oh, he's done this or this or this. But no, you're absolutely right. He definitely did do a serviceable job. He, you know, got the right amount of humor out of them at the humorous moment. You know, nothing was overplayed. Nothing was underplayed.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah. They are not overdoing the Dutch angles yet at this point.
Well, no. No, that's not going to be until second season when it really plays up.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, you know. Overall, mm-hmm. I mean, like I say, here, the rating. If you were Robin watching this mm-hmm. episode, it's over. You turn to Batman. Holy.
Holy Dewey Decimal System, Batman.
So you enjoyed it, though.
Yes, very much so. It mm-hmm. still holds up.
It holds. And I think that's the key thing. It holds up. Yeah. Mm-hmm. As you know, Batman 66 episodes go, it holds up.
Yes. Yeah, great, solid performances out of everybody, a great, well-performed villain, and a very interesting plot that does, like I said, it's like, what is he up to? Oh, okay. It's a robbery.
Oh, no, I agree. Absolutely. All right, well, that's going to do it then for this episode of the Batcave podcast. Gary, as far as
yes.
the RevCast, as far as DragonCon, and as far as just your own, you know, wanderings about the internet, how can people keep up with you and all the things that you do?
Well, you can follow me on Twitter as Gary_Mitchell, and that's Mitchell with one L, and Star Trek fans, yes, it's my real name. You can find me on Facebook at the Revolution SF Facebook page, at the DragonCon American Sci-Fi Classics Facebook page. And you can also follow the wonderful Joe Crow, who is my cohort with the American Sci-Fi Classics, as YoJoeCrow on Twitter as well.
Okay. And RevCast?
The RevCast at RevolutionSF.com and on iTunes. RevCast and RevNews for all your nerdity. For a convention panel in your pocket.
I like that. I like that.
Thank you.
So that is going to do it, folks. Next time around.
Next week, the return of the Riddler.
Yeah, he's going to be in the movie, but we're not going to see Frank Gorshin as the Riddler until the third season. So, you know, to have his swan song go off successfully, I've asked Mr. Bob Greenberger, writer, editor extraordinaire, to help me along with sending off the Riddler in high fashion. So make sure you stay tuned for that. Make sure you stay tuned for all the great programming we have here on the Chronic Rift Network. And I'll see you all in 2 weeks' time. So until next time, Gary, thanks so much. Chums, take care. Thanks for listening, chums. I don't have a bat phone, but you can contact the Batcave Podcast through its Facebook page, Twitter, email, at thebatcavepodcast@gmail.com or by phone at 888-866-9010. Subscribe to the podcast via Libsyn.com. That's Libsyn.com. Or through iTunes. The Batcave Podcast is part of a series of pop culture podcasts from the Chronic Rift Network. Find them at chronicrift.com. So until next time, citizens, same bat time, same Batcave Podcast.
I thought it was the least I could do, Commissioner, after reading about that dreadful business in the newspapers, the Bookworm affair. And I feel our prison libraries could use some new uplifting titles.
Yes, yes, shocking. A man of Bookworm's education. How could such a fellow turn to a life of crime?
I'd say it's an example of the old precept. A little knowledge is a dangerous thing.
A wise observation, Bruce. I'll remember that. By the way, would you like to see him?
Bookworm?
He's just outside, waiting conveyance to the penitentiary.
Gosh, Bruce, I'd sure like to see a real crook in the flesh.
Well, I don't see any harm in it, Dick, as long as he's under sound restraint.
Get them, Chief O'Hara.
Yes, sir.
Them?
His female accomplice, too, a Miss Limpert. Very sad case, that one.
All right, bring her in. Come on, boys. All right, you crooks. And remember, be polite to Mr. Bruce Wayne, too.
The world's 100 greatest crimes. You abandoned child. Is there no hope for you? As you can see, Bruce, your gift was sorely needed.
May I keep that as a souvenir, Commissioner?
Oh, yes, certainly.
Thank you. What are you smiling at, Bookworm?
Oh, I am so much cleverer than all of you, you see. Oh, as the poet says, they who lose today may win tomorrow.
Wrong, Bookworm. Not the poet. That line's from Cervantes' Don Quixote. Part 1, Book 1, Chapter 7.
Huh, the devil. Why, this fellow, he is almost as obnoxious as Batman.
All right, out, out, out. Come on.